the following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
When Nicole Sandler sits down to do her show, she's the producer, booking the guests, pulling the audio, planning the show, the engineer, running the controls, troubleshooting any problems, playing the sounds, calling the guests, and she's the webmaster, hosting the podcast, maintaining the website. Not to mention the host, interviewing guests, explaining the issues, giving opinions, and calling out the bad guys. And then you get The Nicole Sandler Show on NicoleSandler.com.
The point is, Ursula tried to silence the voice of a mermaid just like Donald Trump silenced the voices of black people. Proof positive, Ursula and Donald Trump are the same cartoon villain. Why, just last week, I was near Mar-a-Lago, and I heard Ursula singing a song. She did look strangely orange. Now it all makes sense. I admit I put the ass in doing the nasty. I'm not kidding, I'll move on you like a bitch. But I learned in early days, lawyers have their ways. It's great when you are white and you are rich. Rich, sort of. Now I fortunately rule a mob of MAGAs, who I would whenever I'm distressed. Think I'm crazy, hey, don't scoff. They pay me to rip them off if I promise that black votes will be suppressed. Poor unfortunate trolls, pain in need. But they think that I'm a winner, and with me they'll rule the world. And do I use them? Yes, with greed. Anti-abortionate trolls, pro-life, for who? But they flock to Mar-a-Lago and pay fees, a personal fees. Do I exploit them? Fuck, I do. Now it's happened once or twice. Politicians paid the price when they denied that my election was all. Those who once had a complaint, like Ted Cruz, they lick my taint. My extortionate hole. Now, you've all heard of the art of the deal. It's when you pay off a prostitute in exchange for her voice. Only she doesn't keep quiet. And don't get me started on all of that body language. They don't get that. I can't control my bladder. It's okay, I hate the people they abhor. But their vision is so blurred, I could probably sell a turd. My flying monkeys, that's what MAGA rabble's for. While they're not all that well-versed in conversation, unless it involves a Brandon or a Heil, I dog whistle, then sit back, then they go on the attack and kiss my ass, which always makes me smile. Come on, you poor and corpulent moles! One less chance to raise your voice. If they bring me back to power, I assure you I will stay, cause after that, there'll be no choice. No, your subordinate role I command you do. If I should hint at violence, well, you know what you've been told. I'll watch you fight until your death will both achieve goal. You'll get all the hate you want, and I'll get all your gold. My poor
Kinsey Six, and chances are you've heard them here on this show because they have been on this show. And oh my goodness, that recorded at one of their live shows recently. How awesome. Kinsey Six, S-I-C-K-S. And if you go to NicoleSandler.com, you can find the show that they were on. Yeah, they're awesome. To Kate in the chat room, who obviously wasn't here a couple of weeks ago. Yes, it is Tuesday and Laffy is fine, but she's in the middle of selling her house and moving, to Canada. So, she's not, here and she's taking a leave of absence sort of from the show and, she may or may not return. So I'm sure she'd love to hear from you, though. hearing audio dropouts. I don't know why. Something, as usual, strange is going on. It seems a little low, and that's why I've been sort of playing in the background. And I will, as we continue to try to get this audio where it should be. There's a thing that I actually do on my microphone, and I can't figure it out now. So I guess during the show is not the time. Anyway, did you guys hear the hearing this morning? I'll try to adjust it while we're talking. The audio at the U.S. District Court of Appeals in Washington, D.C. had a hearing. It was the one that the Supreme Court kicked back, I believe, the hearing on immunity. Donald Trump claims he has absolute immunity because at one point he was president. Dun, dun, dun. Yeah. So he was president, and he thinks that means he can do whatever he wants. Sort of reminiscent of, do I still have this clip? Of this.
Well, when the president does it, that means that it is not illegal.
Right? So this is the modern day version of that.
And he has to be careful because that can happen to him also. The next president, whoever that is, the statute of limitations that go back 6 years.
Oh, this is
That's
his
a long
threat,
time, Joe.
Actually,
you have to be very careful. We have to guard and protect our country. We have to do what's right for our country. You don't indict your political opponent because he opposes the corrupt election, which you know was corrupt. Everybody knows it was corrupt. The American public knows it was corrupt.
No, we don't know it was corrupt because it wasn't corrupt. Opponent.
Thank you very much.
You don't indict your political opponent. But his lawyer argued in court this morning that he could assassinate his political opponent. He could have SEAL Team 6 assassinate his political opponent and not be prosecuted if there was not an impeachment and conviction in the Senate. Sound convoluted? It should, because it is. Anyway, this is the clip that I thought I was playing.
Eventually, we win. A president has to have immunity. And the other thing is, I did nothing wrong. We did nothing wrong.
A president has to have immunity, and I did wrong. Not true. Not true. Yeah, this hearing. I'm going to play you one clip from the hearing before we get Digby on. Digby's here today. You know, it's not the beginning of a new year without a show with Digby. But so he was in, he showed up at court today. By the way, he went out and spoke to the cameras and said that he was dragged off the campaign trail and he had to be there. He didn't have to be there today. There was no reason for him to be there today. He didn't tell why. He wasn't called. It was just the lawyers arguing, and my God, his lawyer was horrible. And in fact, you'll hear, if I can find where the clip is. Kiss the campaign. Okay, here it is. Oh, damn. Okay. So, all right. So this is from this morning's hearing. The scratchy voice guy sounding sky here. That's Trump's attorney.
Could a president order SEAL Team 6 to assassinate a political? That's an official act in order to SEAL Team 6.
He would have to be and would speedily be, you know, impeached and convicted before the criminal
what
prosecution.
If you weren't? What if he weren't? There would be no criminal prosecution, no criminal liability for that.
Chief Justice's opinion in Marbury against Madison and the and the plain language of the impeachment judgment clause all clearly presuppose that what the founders were concerned about was not.
I asked you a yes or no question.
Yes, she did.
Could a president who ordered SEAL Team 6 to assassinate a political rival impeached? Would he be subject to criminal prosecution?
If he were impeached and convicted first. And so
your answer is
my answer is qualified yes.
My answer is a qualified yes. He could go out and assassinate his political opponent if he were not tried in impeachment, if he were not impeached by the House and then convicted by the Senate. I don't know where this guy went to law school. I didn't law school. I'm not a lawyer. I don't even play one on the radio. And even I know that that's
bullshit.
It's what?
Bullshit.
Yeah, it is. Ed the Second says, is RFK Trump's lawyer? No, he's just taught his Alex Jones doing his best Alex Jones impersonation. All right. I don't know about you, but I'm ready. I'm ready to hear from our pal Digby. Damn it. I realized I've got her intro. I'm going to try to pull it up here. So, because I always screw up her intro when she's here. And I realize, you see, Digby's not doing Zoom. Zoom comes up on this computer. Digby's going to be on the phone. She comes up on this computer. I have all my sound on this computer. And so if I bring her up, she won't hear what's playing. So I'm trying to open her intro. And I can do it. Just I can walk and chew gum at the same time sometimes. I just have to find the right file. Bear with me. It's not that one. It's daily files. Okay. And then it's Digby intro because I'm so organized. Here we go. Now I'll call Digby. My timing was off, but there she is. Hello.
Hello. I'm
hey,
here.
Hey, Digby. It's Nicole. We're on the air.
Nice to talk to you.
Nice to talk to you too. Happy New Year.
You too.
Yeah.
You too. So, y'all settled in?
Getting there. Finally, I've been doing the yard sale Goodwill tour of Central Arizona to furnish the house, and I need rugs. This house has all, tile floors that look like wood. So the studio, it's a fairly big room, and it's so echoey. So I finally I've got like egg crate stuff over the window now, and I have two big area rugs in here, and I think finally it's not sounding like I'm in a giant bathroom anymore. fun things like that.
That's fun. Yeah, that sounds like fun stuff, actually. I mean,
it is. I'll tell you something. Furnishing a house from, because we brought really nothing. We brought zero furniture. We left everything in Florida. Couldn't sell anything because none of our stuff. So we left and came here and yard sales and Goodwill. And I'll tell you, I've been like refinishing some furniture. I got a beautiful desk for $12. That I stripped and it's gorgeous underneath. So I'm having fun doing stuff like that in my spare time.
Absolutely. That's great. And kind of, it's a way to be a little creative and
that's
also
right.
Get outside your head, get away from this awful political situation. And,
yes.
You know.
Which honestly has been my kind of goal that I tune out the news. Not that there are many great, certainly over our television outlets to watch anymore. But it's all so depressing. And you know what? I subscribe to a lot of newsletters and a lot of online. And I get up and I do my news gathering first thing in the morning. I go through everything. And so I don't need to watch the asinine commentary.
No, you don't have to.
You know?
You don't need to.
No, even the
Sunday
shows.
Do you listen to podcasts while you're doing
you know
this
what?
Stuff?
You know, I
this,
don't.
You know, highly recommend. I mean, I'll send you a list of ones
Please.
That I like
okay.
And others because I find that when I'm doing like manual labor, like I do it when I'm gardening or cleaning the kitchen or doing whatever. And, it's just it's at times when I don't have to put my mind anything else.
Mm-hmm.
This sort of mindless work. Some of these podcasts really informative. There's some great people out there doing them. It might be something since you've got these other projects going that maybe it'd be something that you might enjoy.
Maybe. But I'll tell you something. I listen to music because music
hey.
Takes me out of this mess. So
I remember that.
Right? And music, I'll tell you something. When I was in my deep depression after Trump was elected, I had a really rough, at least first year after he came into office. Right? And that's when I was dealing with cancer, too. I had lung cancer. that. So I had just had surgery, thankfully, but during the end of the election, it was horrible. And I fell into a deep depression. It was music that got me out of it. Just turning off the news and listening. So
totally get it. Totally get it. And yes, and that feeds the soul in a way that no amount of information can possibly do. So you're absolutely right. That's the way to, you know, sort of get some meditation going on while you're doing your manual projects.
Exactly. Exactly. So playing with all kinds of stuff. I did, you know what? Let me see if I can. Oh, you're not on Zoom, so you wouldn't see anyway. I just did this big project over the holiday break. We had bought, you know, we did our big yard sale run when we first got here and found this big sort of cathedral window looking thing, that is a wood frame basically. And so I came up with this technique for faux stained glass. We will get to the politics. Don't worry. We just have to, it's been a while. So,
just wait.
I came up with this technique because I play like a little kid in arts and crafts with using clear glue and alcohol ink. And I make like a, well, this one, just so the people listening can hear, it uses that technique. It's, and this is on a mirror, but it's clear glue with alcohol ink. And I make a sort of a film that it peels. When you were a kid, did you ever put Elmer's glue in your hand and let it dry and peel it off?
Right, we all did.
That's the premise of this technique. I put it on glass, I color it with alcohol ink, let it dry for a day or two, and it peels off like vinyl. And so then I cut it out, and when you glue it on glass or plexiglass, it sort of wrinkles up, it crinkles, and like, and it gives you a stained glass effect. It's really cool. So I did this big desert scene. Maybe tomorrow I'll bring it into the studio and put it behind me. But yeah, so I take great joy in just unplugging from all
of this. Fabulous. Yeah, and you needed a change.
Yeah.
So this is perfect. And, yep. You know, that stuff is fun. It's great. It's great for the head. For
it sure. is. It is. And I'll tell you something. They have a Goodwill out here probably every, like, mile. It's within 10 minutes of here, there's at least 4 or 5 of them. And the price is right. I found this end table lamp. It, like, the lamp to the table. I got 2 of them. I refinished them. They're gorgeous. And it was like $6 each. So
wow.
That's I'm going to have to do a new show, how to furnish
really?
Your house from Goodwill and, you know, videotape going in and picking out things. Yeah. So anyway, that's how are things in Santa Monica?
Hey, same. Nothing changed. Just, you know, another day in paradise.
Gotcha. Well, let's get to it. So this morning, I don't know, but I'm guessing you as well were tuned into C-SPAN audio because there was no video in this D.C. courtroom, but it was the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, a 3-judge panel hearing Donald Trump's claim to have immunity because he's president. I was aghast at some arguments that his lawyer was making.
Oh, it was ridiculous. I mean, they're really grasping at straws. This idea, I mean, it's absurd. My favorite part is the fact that his own lawyers argued that he wasn't immune from criminal prosecution during his impeachment. Yeah, I mean, the argument that he's making, his lawyers are making, I mean, you know, let's just give them a little bit of a break. They don't have much to work with.
No.
So, you know, I mean, they really do have to grasp at straws. But, I mean, they're making this argument that unless he had been impeached and convicted of a crime while president, he can't be indicted for the crime after he's president. It's absolute boggles your mind
yes.
that they would say that. And there's really no basis. If anything, the Constitution says the opposite. It says that you can be, indicted for a crime if you were impeached and, if you were impeached.
Right.
So the whole idea here is just ridiculous. And you know, it's the best they've got going for them. But you had to, you know, I don't think, I mean, I don't know about you, but I did not get the impression that this panel was impressed with their argument. No. Let's put it that way.
Not
at all. Asked them, at some point, they even asked, you know, so what you're saying is that unless the president, a former president, had ordered SEAL Team 6 to assassinate his political rival, had been impeached and convicted, he could not be held liable for that criminally after he was out of office. And the lawyer's forced to say no.
Yeah,
I mean, he couldn't be.
No.
That's ridiculous. I mean, basically what they're saying is that if you don't get, you know, here's what you do. Do whatever you want and then resign. They can't do any, you know, you can murder your entire cabinet if you want to.
You know what? I played that clip before I brought you on, so the listeners certainly heard it. And it's just, it's so astounding. And I'm surprised that none of the judges said, where did you get this notion? Because it's out of thin air. It's absurd.
Well, it's ridiculous. And you know, this is, you know, just, you know, looking at it from the big picture. I mean, there is no lawyer that I have heard, not one that I've heard on TV or read, that thinks there's any merit to these lawyers'
right.
argument. So what that means is that, A, they're delaying, which mm-hmm. we know they're going to try and delay. And then they're going to try to get it to the Supreme Court where, as Trump's other lawyer, Alina Haba, said a few days ago, you know, that, well, he did a lot for Kavanaugh and, you know, really went to bat for him. So he'll step up.
Wow.
and then, you know, I mean, and Trump himself, he backed that, too. He post saying, well, I chose these justices and I'm sure they'll do the right thing,
right.
You know, that kind of thing. Well, that's what they're hoping for. I mean, that's what that they would get a partisan Supreme Court decision.
That's right.
That would, you know, that would get him off the hook, because if this immunity thing, you know, if it succeeded, that's the end of the ball game, right? I mean, there's nothing left.
Right. But there's
so
no way.
That's the big Hail Mary.
Right. And so, and this is the one that that Jack Smith tried leapfrog over the appeals court and go directly to the Supreme Court, knowing that it's going to wind up there anyway. And the delay tactics, what Trump's going to do now, see, this is how they do it in the appeals court. You get a 3-judge panel, but his appeal doesn't go directly to the Supreme Court. He's going to next say, I want it on bank, meaning he wants the entire, all the judges in this DC circuit to, as a group, decide. So that's going to be another time suck before he gets to the Supreme Court.
That's right. And, you know, and eventually it is going to. I mean, what this does is, you know, they want to put this off as far into the. And there was a big story, I can't remember, I think it was in the One Post over the weekend, about what the real strategy is here, which is, of course, political, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think, you know, Trump would like to have all this settled and have the Supreme Court say that, you know, he has total immunity and can go out and shoot people on Fifth Avenue if he wants to. But I don't know that they actually think that's going to happen. But what they do want to do is push off any kind of a trial to the point where they could where they can make the argument that he is now an official nominee of the Republican Party. They want to get the primaries done. It's one of the reasons why they're pushing so hard in places, you know, when they don't have to, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they're pushing very hard, even in Iowa, New Hampshire. They want to bring up as quickly as possible. And, you know, he's going to win, right?
Of course.
I mean, I think they feel perfectly confident in that. But they want to win quickly so that they can then have this argument that this is, you know, that this goes beyond politics and try and push the courts, wherever they are, including the Supreme Court, of course, into making the, you know, decision that this should not be settled before the election, that it would interfere with the election, sort of like the way the Justice Department doesn't do anything in the, I don't know what, 90 days before the election or whatever.
Well, allegedly, because remember back to 2016 when James Comey went out and basically threw the election to Donald Trump by saying, oh, there's more from Hillary Clinton. What? When there wasn't.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's you know, and it's just a policy, right? I mean, it has no bearing in law or anything. And the same thing would be true if this were to happen. But they want to have that argument, so they're pushing hard. They want to do it, and ostensibly, his campaign Yeah, Trump's campaign is kind of interesting because he has a couple of people that are actually professionals. Mm-hmm. Her name is Susie Wiles, and the other one is a guy named Chris LaCivita. And those two are kind of trying to strategize this in a way to give him an advantage, or at least to you know, mitigate some of the threat from these legal cases to the campaign. And so that's what they're trying to do, is just get this so they can make this argument on a political level, and whether and hope against hope that maybe it you know, then sort of trickles into the legal system as well, and people start to have, you know, cold feet about going forward with these cases. But it's also, you know, the case that they are you know, they're saying anyway, they're out there, you know, kind of claiming that what they want to do is clear Trump's calendar, because they're afraid that they're afraid that these cases are going to interfere with his ability to campaign.
What a
sad thing when you're a criminal and you don't get to carry on with your business because you get caught and have to go to trial.
And,
I mean,
and
it's,
you've got
it's
so
a terrible
many
thing.
Trials.
No one should have to endure
right.
that.
And so
it's
many
just
trials
not right.
going on. Too. So, you know, he may have to go to Florida or D.C. or New York or
anything could happen. Well, they're sort of, so they're trying to make argument too that, you know, this is unfair. And it's, you know, and then Trump, he's out there grandstanding today at the appellate argument, which he has absolutely no reason to be there. And he's claiming, oh, I should be on the campaign trail, but here I am.
Right. He had
you
to
know,
be,
well,
he did not have to be. Yeah, they dragged me off the campaign trail. No, they didn't. You didn't have to be there today.
He didn't have to be there today. He doesn't have to be at the civil trial. In fact,
right.
I mean, he's not required to appear at anything until he actually goes to trial.
That's
at
right.
this point.
Yep.
You know, so this is all stupid. But,
right.
you know, he does that, of course, because there's going to be cameras there and everybody's going to be paying attention.
Well.
And he wants to be able to, you know, to make a statement. And he did. And he made, you know,
a threat.
Kind of, I mean, he was
a
out
threat.
There making a threat.
It was a threat. Hold on. Hey, Digby, I've got a man standing behind me because
my
husband, and he wants to say something.
Question. So if the immunity argument does prevail, wouldn't that mean that Biden could also order SEAL Team to take out the lard father?
Absolutely. That's exactly what you know. I mean, I think Trump maybe forgets sometime that he's not the president right now.
Right.
maybe
That's
he should
right.
think about that.
Yeah, he says things.
You know, obviously, we know that Biden wouldn't do that, but nonetheless, you know, it'd be tempting, wouldn't it?
Yeah. So this was today. So this was he goes out after the hearing, which was not a good hearing for him. And he finds cameras, and he says this.
And he has to be careful, because that can happen to him also. The next president, whoever that may be, has a statute of limitations that go back years. That's a long time, Joe. You have to be very careful.
You have to be very careful. 6 years, statute of limitations.
For a country, you don't indict your political opponent.
Now you murder him. No, we don't. No, we don't. It was not.
You don't indict your political opponent.
No, you assassinate them, I guess.
Well, I mean, that must be. Remember Trump 16, you know, debate?
Could shoot someone on Fifth Avenue.
You'd be in jail. You know,
right.
I mean, come on. This is absurd. But
this
you know,
is the guy who said
he
could go out and shoot someone on Fifth Avenue and get away with it. Well, duh.
Yeah, and he wouldn't lose it. It appears that they just love it. The more criminal he is, the better they like him. But you know, the other problem for him here is that you know, he is he's facing this. I just lost my train of thought. I'm sorry. I had a man standing in my room too.
Those men.
No, get out of here, man.
Right.
Yeah. In any case, this is. The whole argument that they're making completely ridiculous. And I know what it was. When he came out, he also claimed that if the Supreme Court does not grant him this immunity, does not say, you know, rule that he has immunity, he said bedlam is going to break out. And he's using these arguments. It's not just for legal purposes. It's not just for the election. It's also, and I hope everybody's ready for this, it's for the post-election. If he loses, because this is not, he's not going to accept it. He's out there saying, I'm leading in all the polls by double digits and blah, blah, blah. Well, he isn't. That's
right.
Not true.
Right.
He is not leading in all the polls. That's a lie. But he's building up this idea among his crazy people that he's way, way ahead in the polls, that he's completely unbeatable, that the election is practically over as far as he's
for
concerned.
The Republican primary, anyway.
For,
right.
Well, I mean, I think he's saying the general election is practically over. Joe
for
Biden
him.
Is completely, you know, he's so unpopular he can't possibly win. And he is way, way ahead in the polls, and he is saying that he's ahead, that he's beating Biden, which is not true. And so what he's doing is setting up this belief system in his cult that, you know, he will have won, and it will be obvious. And all this stuff about bedlam, and, you know, he's setting it up so that there will be more violence. I
right.
just don't think that there's any doubt that a lot of what he's saying, and it could be even before the election. I mean, a lot depends on what happens. If this trial happens, I think he's setting it up around the trial if he is found guilty.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
well, he's asked.
What he's doing.
He was asked today, and I don't have the audio up, but he was asked, will you tell people, you know, regardless of the outcome of the election, no violence? And he wouldn't. He wouldn't
Absolutely,
answer the question.
He walked away. I
yep.
mean, this is where, you know, this is what we're dealing with here. He is, you know, setting this whole thing up. We can see it coming. I mean, I wrote a piece this week. It was, you know, sort of looking at the anniversary of January 6th
uh-huh.
and how Biden handled it, how Trump then, you know, responded, I guess, in these ridiculous rallies he had in Iowa this week.
Yep.
Stuff he was saying, I mean, it's January 6th, called them hostages.
And oh my
said
God.
It was run by that the FBI was leading the charge, you know, that day. And, you know, I mean, just nutty stuff. And so, in essence, I came away on Sunday night, you know, I'm just kind of sitting here, geez, you know, it's January 6th, it's groundhog day, you know, it's every, it's going to be, we're going to do it again with what I at this election is underneath everything else. There are a lot of issues, a lot of problems, a lot of barriers for Joe Biden to try to get over, a lot of problems with the Biden cult, I mean, with the Trump cult.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end of the day, that's what it is. It's January 6th, and that is where we're at. And I will tell you something. I was listening to, I think both, I do watch the TV because, you know, and on CNN and on MSNBC this morning, they had reporters up in New Hampshire and over in Iowa.
Uh-huh.
And all of them were saying, now maybe this is just anecdotal, it's just some kind of padding thought that they, you know, some coincidence they had that. But they were talking to Nikki Haley voters.
Yes.
And Chris Christie, and I don't know, are there any DeSantis voters? I don't know.
Not anymore. He's down to like 5% in New Hampshire. He has just plopped.
What a dud.
Yes.
But they were talking to voters and saying, you know, well, what's your reason? You know, why are you voting for her and not Donald Trump, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera? And all of them said it was January 6th
Good.
And the big lie about the election. Now, maybe that was just random and it was just, but it occurred to me that this issue, and it sort of, you know, validated my thesis of my piece anyway, that, you know, that is the underlying issue that runs through this whole thing. And, you know, and Biden, I think, framed that well in his speech about it being, you know, it is the threat to democracy and this threat of Donald Trump and him, you know, spouting, you know, Hitler slogans and saying to be a dictator. That's for real. I mean, that is for real. That's what we're dealing with. And I think on some level, that's really what this is going to be about. And the frightening thing is, Nicole, look how many millions of people are, you know, they're all for the dictatorship.
That's
they like
what
the
I don't
talk.
Get.
They're with him, you know, and that's scary.
That's what's
that
terrifying,
is scary stuff.
Right? Because look, my question is, how could it be close? Even how could so many people say that they're going to vote for Donald Trump? What do they find about him that qualifies him to be president? It's just mind-boggling, and the fact that even in the polling it's close. And I know, it's polling, it's 9 months out, it's don't stop. I guess there are warning signs you got to watch. Now, Biden's both of his speeches on Friday and on yesterday were really good. And that's the kind of stuff he needs to do. He needs to call Trump out by name, yep, which he's finally doing. But it take a lot of that. And
it's going to take a lot of it. I mean, there's a lot of work to do because these polls, and believe me, I don't think they hold any water at the moment. And I'm not really sure they're fully capturing what's going on out in the country because it's a very bizarre time. It's within the margin of error. Yeah. I mean, it is really, really close. And should be complacent. And no one should be fatalistic. You don't go one way or the other here. Well, he's got it won. No, Trump does not have this thing won by any means. But it's very close. And you know, we have to be, you know, it's going to take some real effort here. And I agree with you about Biden, that his two speeches were good. I think the framing of this election, I think what they wanted to do was set down, you know, it was the, sort of the formal opening of the campaign. And sound what they thought that the main theme was underlying it. And, you know, it was on a number of levels because the idea that, you know, about abortion rights that pertains to them trying to take away our rights.
Yep.
And trying, you know, and threatening our freedom to live, you know, the way that we choose. And, you know, a lot of this should play into old-fashioned Republican ideas about individual liberty. But, of course, you know.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Not, yeah.
You know, no, that's done.
Of course. Right. The Republican, former conservative Republican playbook, it doesn't really matter to this maggot group, because they're not about ideology. They're about winning at all costs and deeming anyone who's not with them the enemy and guilty of treason in the worst possible terms. And people wonder why there's so much animosity and such, you know, ugliness out there now. It's coming right from him. But I got to play. So last night, I did watch something. I don't remember what was on, but this clip came on and I burst out laughing. And David came in. He said, "What's funny?" I'm going to play this. Hopefully you can hear this. I made some adjustments. So the chat room said they couldn't hear the last clip I played. Ugh. So you probably didn't either. But hopefully you'll hear this one. It's short. It's only 20 seconds. But he was talking about the economy. Well, here.
We have an economy that's incredible. We have an economy that's so fragile. And the only reason it's running now is it's running off the fumes of what we did, what the Trump administration. It's just running off the fumes. And when there's a crash, I hope it's going to be during this next 12 months, because I don't want to be Herbert Hoover.
I did. I heard.
The economy is running off. It's so great because it's running off the fumes of what he did. Are you fucking kidding me? And then he hopes for a crash, and he hopes it happens, obviously, before November because he thinks he's going to get into office. And so he wants everyone to suffer and there to be a crash so he can come in afterwards. It's like, oh my
God. And he won't, he won't have to be Herbert Hoover.
Right.
I mean, I know. I heard that last night, too. And I'm just going, you know, this guy, I mean, he's so verbally incontinent. I mean, the way that he just kind of blurts out everything these days. I mean, that, you know, plays in, we should talk about it. You know, what's wrong, what's going on with Donald Trump? Because he's not normal,
yes,
even by his own standards right now. But
right,
that comment was really very telling. And the idea, first of all, that the economy's running on the fumes of his economy is absurd. He was running on the fumes of the recovery from the financial crisis.
Yeah.
And then the whole thing, I mean, remember what it was like when he left office?
Yes.
I mean, what was unemployment? 10%? I mean, it was insane. And,
you know,
it was obviously the pandemic played into that, which he mismanaged so badly.
Of course. It was a disaster under him. Well, but he made another comment the other day that I don't have, but what he said, he was trying to invoke Ronald Reagan, and he said, "Are you better off now than you were 5 years ago?" He didn't say 4 years ago. He said 5 years. years ago, because 4 years ago, we were overtaken by COVID and no one was doing well. So before he came into office, it's just the man knows no shame.
No, well, we know that. I mean,
he killed irony. He killed irony.
You know, he has always been very, very sloppy in his, you know, rhetoric and the kind of, you know, sort of ridiculous meandering thoughts that he would try to articulate when he's doing these rallies. But I'm telling you, I have seen a lot of these. I mean, it's my job. I have to watch them, and I do dutifully, and then I drink afterwards because I need to.
I smoke legal weed here in Arizona now. So,
I mean, it's bad. But, you know, I do this because, you know, I have to. And so the point is I've seen a lot of them. From the very beginning, from when he first came down the escalator to even going back birther period, yeah, when he was doing all that, even before he announced to run in 2015. And I've seen a lot of it. And I'm telling you, there's something different now. He is not the same person. He's not the same person. He's the same person. He's lost quite a bit of his verbal acuity.
Yes. Not that he ever had much to begin with.
No, it was always bad. But, yes. I mean, it's really noticeable now. And he also gets off into these tangents that, I mean, he would always do it once in a while where he'd get off into something like his thing that he did over the weekend about the magnets and the elevators and how he knows that you don't use magnets because if you throw them in water, they lose their power, and they should have called in John Deere because he's in Iowa. So he thought, oh, what do you know about John Deere? And it had something to do with elevator. I mean, it was really out there. And he that's just weird. That's weird even for him. And he does that a lot. You know, he did a thing where he was talking about California and the water problem and how, you know, they have a big valve up in Northern California that if they would just turn it on, they could save all the water. They could save all the water, and instead, or if they turn it off, they could save all the water, but they turn it on and all the water goes ocean, and just some really weird stuff. And, you know, he's doing more of that. I guess that's the point. He's just doing more of this stuff where he is just not making any sense at all. And the fact that he's getting away with it, and, you know, the media has been fairly good in the last few days showing his Nazi stuff and showing, you know, his dictator stuff and over the weekend some of the stuff about the hostages and all that. But they're not showing that, and I really think they should. And, you know, they're so highfalutin, though, they have to say, well, it comes cost to us. And I'm going, no, it doesn't. It comes at cost to us.
Yes.
If you don't show the public what this guy is actually saying. There's just a lot of weird stuff there that he's saying now. And, he looked terrible. He looks just awful. He's, you know, obviously he's aging, but the makeup thing is just really over the top. And he's got a full Flock of Seagulls haircut now where it's just wild. And
to say that his hair has gotten worse, to say that he that his coloring is worse is, because if we go back to, say, 2016, he was already orange with a dead animal on his head. And now we're saying he looks even worse. It's this man deteriorating from a position already, you know, I get where we said there is no basement. He keeps going down, down, down. And yet people support him. That's, again, what I don't get. I would like to speak to somebody who supports him to find out how they could go there, but I've seen enough of those clips.
Misinformation.
Yeah,
I mean, part of it is that you know, they do their own research.
Yes,
I think that says it all. And that's part of it. The other part is that they, you know, that for them, for a lot of them, it is just sheerly a team sport, and they're supporting him. Some of them will even say it outright when interviewed. Well, they're just going after him so hard, I have to support him.
Oh, God.
I mean, it has nothing to do with, I mean, this isn't politics for a lot of these people. It's not politics for them. It's something else. It's, you know, it's a sporting event or some kind of tribal, you know, dance of some sort. But it's not politics as we have been, you know, have understood it to be until now. He's created a whole new style of politics, you know, as a demagogue, cult leader, you know, kind of entertainer. And so it's very hard to sort of, I don't think that they're operating on a level of any kind of political logic that, you know, well, they'll say it, oh, I really care about it. You know, I just agree with his policies, but I don't like what he says on Twitter. You know, they'll say stuff like that. But if you ask them what their policies they agree with, they don't have a clue. They don't know what they're talking about.
No, they don't. And that, you know, that is the product of all the disinformation that's out there. All of these sites that call themselves news, which are nothing but propaganda. I really think, again, we got to go back to 1996 and Bill Clinton's Telecommunications Act that deregulated so much of the media that allows for this crap to go on.
Yeah. Well, it surely had a lot to do with it. And then this proliferation of digital media where it's just, you know,
the internet,
you've got
the rise
coming
of the internet.
At you from any. Every different direction, right? I mean, your people are overwhelmed. And these folks have decided that, you know, they found a bubble that makes them happy and they're comfortable with, and they're, you know, so they stay in it and they're happy to do that. They don't venture out beyond it at all. And so all they hear is that, you know, and they hear that, you know, Trump is the greatest. He had the greatest economy the world has ever seen, all of which, you know, the economic stuff is complete nonsense. We already talked about part of it. And then I just read a Paul Krugman column this morning about he's been looking at the numbers when you look at consumer satisfaction and, you know, views of the economy, generally speaking. One of the things that's not being done in the media reporting on this is just how, you know, flagrantly partisan the responses are.
Yes.
And he compared it, though. Here's the interesting thing. You know, the pundits always, if they note this at all, which they rarely do, but if they note that it's mostly Republicans who are saying the economy is absolutely garbage and they're barely getting by, et cetera, et cetera, they never mention that. You know, they'll say that, well, it's asymmetric. It's, you know, when the Republicans are in, the Democrats say the same thing. But Krugman, in his column, went back and looked, and that's not true.
Right.
The Democrats didn't say the same thing.
No.
When the economy was doing well under Trump, they weren't unhappy economically. They weren't saying we had our complaints about Trump. Yeah. But not that. We weren't saying that the economy was garbage. But that's what Republicans do. And it's skewing the perception of how bad everyone thinks it is. Yes, they think it's win his election, or, you know, they think the election
was stolen because Trump told them it was stolen. And now that Fox is saying, no, it wasn't stolen, Fox is lying. They trust Trump for whatever reason. I'm going to show this video. You can't see it. It's only 12 seconds long, but it's somebody on Twitter. Actually, Jeff Charlotte retweeted this. I love Jeff Charlotte. He posts some amazing stuff. He goes to Trump rallies. He goes to the houses of these crazy Trumpers and talks to them, people who have caches of weapons and stuff. So somebody named Ford Fisher posts, on the way home from Ohio, past this house in Maryland. This is not your this is not your everyday MAGA. This is advanced MAGA. And Jeff Charlotte says, fifth dimensional fascism. And I'm showing the video here now. It's actually a house just with Trump 2024, Trump flag all over this house. It's astounding. But you know what? Jeff Charlotte has shown similar things just from his travels, like his latest book. Of course, the name is escaping me now, and I'll get it one second. His latest book, The Undertow, Scenes from a Slow Civil War, details going into the houses of people like that to see what they're all about. And he still doesn't get answers that satisfy me. It's just they know everything. Sort of reminds me of my daughter when she was little, who knew everything. You couldn't tell her anything because she knew it. Still sort of.
Long felt that it was a case of mass arrested development.
Yeah.
Maybe lead in the water, I don't know. But that particular, that I saw, that I, in fact, I sent that tweet that you just showed to my best friend who lives in Maryland.
Ooh.
And we have, when I visited her, we've driven around in the back roads and what have you. And this is pretty common. It's sort of like eastern Pennsylvania, you know. I mean, it's Trump country. And there's one that's not too far from her, a guy. He has a huge Confederate flag, a huge Trump flag, picture of Joe Biden on the fence with a gun pointed at his head, and a sign that says, "I'm an American. I have a real job."
Oh, my God.
I don't
God.
Even know what that means. But, you know, clearly, you know, this stuff, when you go into Trump country, it's not just Trump, you know, it's not your normal, you know, Trump, you know, whoever he's Trump Pence or whoever is Trump Stefanik. You know, kind of placards on the lawn. It is a full-blown celebration of Trumpiness. I mean, when you look at the rallies and the way these guys have their trucks painted, this whole thing, it's a cult. I mean, I'm sorry.
In fact,
I've been thinking lately that, you know, we need to start studying cults a little bit more because, you know, of course, this is a cult of personality built all the way all around Trump. And we have to hope that's what it is, because if Trump does pass on from the political scene in some way, whether
pass
it's
on
jail,
the operative,
or, yeah, whatever, you know, we have to see what happens to these people, because it's very, very much attached to him. You know, you could see how it sort of played out with a guy like DeSantis, who's really trying to be Trump, you know, Trump 2.0, and they weren't having it. You know, it's Trump or nothing, and I don't know that anybody can really fill his shoes. So that's going to be something we'll have to, but that's a couple of years down the road. Right now, you know, it's very worrisome that these people are, that there are so many of them. I mean, it'd be one thing if it was kind of a small faction of the Republican Party. It is. It's a large, it's the majority of the Republican Party.
And that's what's
and
so scary.
People,
yep.
It's really scary. It's terrifying to me. I mean, I look at this, I watch it every day, and I see this, you know, very cult-like devotion for this guy that has no real bearing on what we understand to be politics. And you can see there's something else going on here. And, of course, you see it all over the world. I mean, did you see the tweet over the weekend? The guys in Italy for the fascist, the
no.
big fascist salute.
No.
Oh my God. Yeah. I think I put it up on my blog if anybody wants to go look for it. It's they apparently there's a commemoration that happens every year where the far right goes to this particular place, the former building where the fascist party used to have their headquarters. And there had been, I guess back in the 70s, there was kind of a murder of a couple of young fascists by a couple of young communists. And this was way back in the 70s. But they go there, the fascists go there every year.
Oh, I see it. This is the Rome, Italy.
Yeah, 2024.
Hold on. Let me get rid of the. It's very reminiscent. Bring it up. It's very reminiscent of the
Mussolini.
Mussolini and the Madison Square Garden thing that happened back in the 30s, right? So here I'm putting this up on the screen. I'll play the video. I wanted to mute that. Hold on. Yeah, not letting me mute it. There you go. Oh my goodness.
You see the mass salute there?
Yeah.
Well, apparently this is, you know, they come there every year for this commemoration, but this year it was huge. And they're all dressed in black shirts, which of course that's Mussolini, right?
Right.
I mean, the black shirts. And they're all doing the fascist salute and they're all, you know, and everybody's. And now this happened year. They just had a far right candidate for a party that was sort of stemmed from this fascist party that had been outlawed. The modern iteration of that party. They just elected this person. This guy, a very far right fascist adjacent new leader. And so everybody's kind of going, whoa, and this is the stuff that's happening. It's not just here. And, you know, and of course, I always look at this and I put that know, people ask me why I call hats, and I do. The MAGA people, I call them red hats, because if you look at a crowd there, you look at that crowd, they're all dressed in black shirts. You look at the Trump crowd, and they're all dressed in red hats. And, you know, there's something very similar, let's just put it that way, about these crowds. And they all have their own flavor, and certainly Donald Trump has his own flavor. He's not your... You know, your grandfather's Nazi. He's something different. But it's underlying in the whole thing is the same kind of cult-like, devotional, you know, mass movement, right, authoritarian, you know, white nationalism.
Right.
And that's basically what we're talking about everywhere.
Everywhere. And it's and that's the scary part. Here we think it's, well, it's Trump. It's the cult of personality and with the capital C for cult. Right. But what explains what's happening around the world?
Exactly.
And the today's Republican Party, they are openly supporting, you know, people like Viktor Orban. CPAC, which I think is dead now, probably thanks to its leaders who, you know, can't keep their dicks in their pants or whatever. they have CPAC conventions in Hungary with Viktor Orban speaking, like keynoting them. But I'll tell you, something happened today that, you know, Mitch McConnell is such a little twerp. So
a grave digger of democracy.
Right. So a reporter asked him, well, here, let me play this clip real quick. He said,
late of the anniversary of January 6th, is it accurate to characterize individuals convicted incarcerated for January 6th related crimes to characterize them as hostages?
The hostage accurate? Question, right? Can you call them hostages?
Well, let me say this about January 6th. I had remarks that I made on February 13th of 21 about how I felt about January 6th. I recently reread it. I stand by what I said.
I wish he would have repeated what he said, because I've got clips from not just January 13th, from January 6th itself, 2021, and it was January. I've got everything chronological here. And let's pull up Mitch McConnell from January 6th. Right, I can picture him right there on the floor after the votes, and he said this. Play.
There's no question, none, that President Trump is practically and morally responsible for provoking the events of the day. No question about it.
No question about
it. The people who stormed this building believed they were acting on the wishes and instructions of their president.
Yep.
And having that belief was a foreseeable consequence of the growing crescendo of false statements, conspiracy theories, and reckless hyperbole, which the defeated president kept shouting into the largest megaphone on planet Earth.
So Mitch McConnell today said, I stand by what I said back then. So Mitch, you need to come out and say it again.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah.
No kidding. And, you know, he also said, and this was mentioned in the hearing today, the immunity hearing, he also said, you know, he can be tried after, you know, the impeachment. He can be tried in a civil, both civilly or criminally. And they repeated that. And I guess he's just wrong about that. I don't know. That's what it seems to be what Trump said. But, yeah, he said all that stuff. You know, a lot of them did. I mean, I did a couple days ago for the January 6th, of the things that these people said, including Kevin McCarthy, including Lindsey Graham, all these people.
Yes. And what, you know, when Lindsey Graham, drunk as he was, got up that night and said, I'm done. I was with him. I can't do it anymore. I was in tears. I'm like, finally, it's over. Count me out. Until the next day when he's got Donald's mushroom in his mouth again. So I don't know.
Oh, God, please, what an image.
I know.
I need to have some brain bleach now.
Right. Perfect ending, closing shot, because I know you have to run. And it's the end of the hour. Digby, find her at salon.com, of course. And Digby's blog, the OG progressive blog out there. It's now at digbysblog.net. and on the shitter still at Digby 56.
Yeah, still there. I'm trying not to be, but I can't help it.
I know. Are you doing any of the others?
I am. I'm on all of them, but you know, it's just I use it mostly for my job. So you know, it's still the place where I can get the best video. The best stuff like that.
Digby, thank you so much. Now we can get on with the year, and we'll talk again soon.
All right. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Digby, everybody. I so love talking to Digby. I just think she's brilliant, and her blog is required reading every day. All right. With that, we're done. It's the end of the hour. I've already run over. I don't know what we're doing tomorrow, but Thursday, Howie Klein will be back, and Friday, Marcy Wheeler will be back, and you know, we'll figure out something for tomorrow. I may just cut up some of the questions and answers from this morning's hearing because it was bizarre, and a lot of people didn't hear. I have the whole thing on tape, so we'll see. We'll see what the day brings. All right. As always, thank you. At least we know Lindsey Graham isn't a size queen. Okay. Touche. All right. With that, until tomorrow, let me get that off the screen. Peace out, everyone.